What's it called?
Monorail.
Once again.
Monorail. I bet that most of you watching right now know this song better than you know Monorails themselves. In fact, statistically, if you're in the United States, you have never been on one. There are only 16 monorail systems in the USA, such as Las Vegas, Disney World in Florida, Disneyland in California, Seattle, Miami Zoo, Jacksonville. Of course, they have a monorail.
Jacksonville, what up?
And a few others. This isn't including the various people movers found at airports like Newark and New York City. So why are monorails, once envisioned as the Jetsons' transport of the future, using magical magnets, are not so present? And why have we got your grandma's boring old trains instead? I'm Nick from Found and Explained, let's find out. Before we dive into today's video, be sure to give Old Maid Nick a like and subscribe if you want to see more videos just like this one. A monorail, by definition, is a train that uses a single track. Some monorail systems use magnets to levitate the monorail car off the rail, but many others use rubber tires to make contact with the track itself. Funnily, this latter design actually has more wheels than normal trains do, requiring one to power the train and another two on either side to keep the car connected to the track. The United States saw its first monorail arrive on its shores for Disneyland back in 1959. Thanks, Mickey. So why would you ever want to build one? A monorail has several advantages over the typical duo railway line. Monorails actually have the least visual impact of all elevated rail options. With a single track, they can seemingly glide aloft those city streets down below and still let in plenty of sunlight compared to older overhead rail lines found in cities like Chicago and New York. Plus, less material is needed to make a monorail, and therefore it can be cheaper. The thinner track doesn't need so much steel, so of the choices, it's pretty affordable for cities. The monorail is also one of the most efficient systems in the world, hardly breaking down and able to maintain around a 99% uptime. It is also less expensive to operate than standard rail. This might have to do with many of the monorail systems being privately owned enterprises, subsidized by the tourist attractions they're affiliated with, rather than public government departments. Another advantage of monorails is that because they're generally on a single looping track, with no crossovers or no other traffic on the line, they can actually operate without a driver or having to slow down, making them able to go between station to station quickly and efficiently. Alas, for as fresh and as cool as they are, monorails have some pretty steep disadvantages compared to the conventional two-rail transport systems, called duo-rail in this context. Okay, we're going to get technical for a second here. In order to achieve stability, the rail in monorail tends to be both significantly wider and taller than you would think based solely on the name. Compared to regular duo rail, the loading gauge of the monorail cars is essentially the same, and thus there is not much of a massive benefit in slightly reducing the footprint of the rail bed. The mass of the vehicles carrying the passengers, if the same as the two-wheel designs, will impact around about the same amount of force and will require the same amount of construction. This means that the same depth for the pylons and the same weight-bearing pillars. And bad news for suspended monorails. They require even more space to place their rail infrastructure. Plus, think about the level crossings and the movement at the ground and underground level. A monorail structure requires at least some elevation at all times, whilst duo rails can cross roads with less than a foot depth required. Despite appearances, when underground, a monorail still requires more superstructure than our friendly standard neighborhood duo rail. Again, suspended monorails are even worse in all three scenarios. Monorails also only make sense if the line is elevated nearly 100% off the track. But beyond that, there are very few transport corridors that make sense. Even at Disney World, they used the monorail to connect between different resorts, but when it came to its Hong Kong Disneyland park, they opted for duo rail due to the underground section and connection with existing rail lines. There is also the technical challenge of switching tracks. On a duo rail line system, because of the way the train sits on top of the tracks, they can crisscross over each other to let another train pass or to swap out engines. On a monorail, because the monorail cars wrap around the entire tracks, you can hardly use the same techniques. Crossover tracks for monorails are not impossible, they're just really slow and costly to build. Plus, it is yet another component that can break down. A small monorail network might not have the extensive switches, but if you want to scale up to a city-wide system, then the technology is limited. And we can't ignore the cost as well. With only a few firms building monorails in the world, they can really charge whatever they like for their proprietary technology, as opposed to open source rail infrastructure. So if monorails are so bad, why do some exist? Monorails got really popular around the middle of the last century, with the cities building the retrofuturism transport options to make a statement. But by the 1970s and 1980s, a monorail was seen as a failed and disappointing public transport system and was beaten out by cheaper alternatives, such as buses, trams, and existing trains. There were only a few places where a monorail made sense over other options, and they were built there more as a stunt than the actual public transport option, like at theme parks or tourist areas. In fact, in the last few years, cities around the world went out of their way to get rid of monorail programs. Sydney built a monorail for the 2000 Olympics, but it barely lasted 2 decades before being torn down. Today, the city is building an underground metro to replace it and integrates thoroughly to other rail systems. In summary, to answer the question of why did monorails not take off and why did they never become the transport of the world of tomorrow? Monorails are a niche transport option. Much more expensive than light rail or streetcars, much more visible than subways, much less flexible than buses, and much more difficult to engineer than duo rail-based systems. And while they are better than elevated trains in terms of blocking out the sky, they still block out the sky. But don't despair, plenty of monorails are still slowly being built around the world, today in China, Istanbul, and Malaysia, with the most extensive set to be completed in the next 5 years with over 40 kilometers of track. China's BYD and Canada's Bombardier plan to add 295 miles of new track by the end of 2020. And to put that into perspective, since 1900, only 254 miles of track has even been built globally. That's more than double. Possible new projects include mass transit in China, worth around $450 billion in 300 different cities, and back home in Los Angeles, connecting the valley with the west side. Speaking to the media in 2017, LA Mayor Eric Garcetti said, "With a small footprint, with electric motors, safety for both earthquake and access, monorail could be on the table." If you enjoyed this video, be sure to click that subscribe button to watch more Found and Explained stories. And if you've ever ridden a monorail, let me know down and bottom in the comments. Take care.
Transportation and Ticket Center, which includes Magic Kingdom car and bus parking. To the right is the Disney created Seven Seas Lagoon. to the left is...